Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our Sunday service. And if this is your first time with us, a special warm welcome on this chilly November morning. Coming up in today's service, James Reid's going to be leading our prayers for us. And with a special treat with our Bible readings, it's a chance to introduce you to some new people, Richard and Virginia Clements, who have joined our church in Welland recently. Virginia is a retired priest from the Diocese of Hereford. And we're very much looking forward to welcoming her onto our service leaders team when she's got permission from the diocese. She's going to be helping out during my sabbatical next year. Anyway, they're going to be bringing our Bible readings to us this morning. I'll be preaching as we look at Ephesians chapter 4 and the way Paul encourages Christians to be imitators of God in the way they resolve disputes amongst themselves. And linking everything together, we've got our usual selection of hymns and songs, which I hope you'll enjoy and which I also hope will help you encounter the Lord as we worship together today. Anyway, I hope you had a good week. Last weekend, when people were out trick or treating, we had our annual Bright Lights party in Upton, and it was terrific fun, very well attended, lots of fun family games. And then the big highlight, I don't know what we call the game, the smoke and light game, which the children absolutely love. You'd hardly think that was Upton Parish Church there in the picture, would you? Anyway, here's a rundown of what's happening this weekend. We've got Breakfast Church in Upton at 9:30. There's also a service at Hanley Swan at 9:30, followed by a service at The Hook at 11:00, and then at Hanley Castle at 6:30. And then looking ahead to next week, we've a midweek communion service on Thursday at Hanley Swan at 10:00. And then, of course, on Sunday, it's Remembrance Sunday. And services will be happening at Earl's Croom at 10:00, 10:45 in Upton, and 10:50 in Ripple and Welland. Obviously, some of those services will be a little more crowded than usual. We are encouraging people to bring their face masks with them if that helps make them feel comfortable. We will be singing, we'll be doing all the usual things we would do on a Remembrance Sunday service, although the services, I think, will be a little shorter than usual. We'll also be ensuring good ventilation throughout, also known as draughty old churches. Anyway, you can find details of all those services and everything else that's happening on our website, hopechurchfamily.org/calendar, and also in our weekly newsletter. Now, before we move on, let me point you in the direction of our online collection. Many of you already give regularly to our churches. We're so grateful for all that you give. But if you don't give, and you would like to, either as a one-off gift or a regular gift to help us through these tricky and uncertain times, do please visit our online giving page, hopechurchfamily.org/giving, where you can choose which of our parish churches you'd like to support. You can also find details for all of our treasurers on there if you'd like to approach them directly. Shall we quieten our hearts? And let's invite God to come and meet with us then as we worship together. Perhaps you could join in with the bits in bold. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Your faithful servants bless you. They make known the glory of your kingdom. Let us pray. Blessed are you, sovereign God, ruler and judge of all. To you be praise and glory forever. In the darkness of this age that is passing away, may the light of your presence, which the saints enjoy, surround our steps as we journey on. May we reflect your glory this day, and so be made ready to see your face in the heavenly city where night shall be no more. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. And let's turn those blessings into praises now. As we stand, if you wish, and we're going to sing, I Cast My Mind to Calvary.
Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears. They him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone.
Do please take a seat. We've sung of the forgiveness that Jesus offers through his death upon the cross. So let's turn back to him now in sorrow for our sin. We'll use the prayer that appears on the screen, but first let's be quiet for a moment just to reflect upon our week and what we need to say sorry for. We say together, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And may Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, our psalm this morning is Psalm 150. It's a wonderful psalm of praise. I'm going to read the odd verses. Perhaps you could join in with the even. So then, Psalm 150. Alleluia! Oh, praise God in his holiness. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him for the blast of the trumpet. Praise him upon the harp and lyre. Praise him with the timbrel and dancers. Praise him upon the strings and pipe. Praise him with ringing cymbals. Praise him upon the clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Alleluia. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Would you pray with me? God of life and love, whose Son was victorious over sin and death, make us alive with his life, that the whole world may resound with your praise through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, now here's Virginia with our first reading.
Our reading is taken from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, beginning at verse 14. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat, preparing their nets. Without delay he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks for reading that for us, Virginia. It's a wonderful passage all about calling us into service as the people of God. Why don't we take up that theme now in our next song, "I, the Lord of Sea and Sky." Why don't you stand for this one if you wish? Do take a seat, and before I come to preach for us, here's Richard Clements with our second reading.
Our first reading is taken from St. Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus, chapter 4, beginning at verse 25. "Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbour, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up to us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Shall we pray? Glorious Heavenly Father, for the gift of your word, we give you thanks and praise. Guide us now as we reflect upon what it is to be an imitator of you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the cruelest things I ever did was humiliate a friend of mine in front of a large crowd of people. It was while I was a university student, part of the Christian Union group there. We were on the Christian Union weekend away, and it was drama night. And I got up and I did a turn. And judging by how much the audience laughed, it was a very good turn as well. So good, in fact, that I decided to milk it by quickly putting together a sequel, which involved me hauling a friend of mine up onto the stage and embarrassing him about something he'd once said. And people laughed, and so I kept on milking it, and I embarrassed my friend further. And at the end of the show, he was quite rightly very upset with me. Jesus said, "By this will all people know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." And on that night, from the way I mocked my brother Christian, no one would have known that I was a disciple of Jesus Christ. Now, over the last few months, we've been thinking occasionally about this letter that St. Paul sent to the church in Ephesus to help them live out their faith. The first three chapters of the letter to the Ephesians is a story of God the Father rescuing a family for himself. And the rest of the letter is all about how God then sends that family out to show his love to the world. And a key concept for how we're to do that is there right at the end of our reading, where it said we're to follow God's example, literally to be imitators of God, who live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us. And this bit of the letter is going to challenge us to do that in lots of very, very practical ways. Time is short, so I'm only going to pick out two main ways in which we can all live that life of love towards one another, which will help us be imitators of God. And here's the first one. Use your words for good and not evil. Use your words for good and not evil. And let's start at the very beginning of the reading, where it says, "Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbour, for we are all members of one body." Now, we all instinctively know why lies are bad, don't we? And yet that doesn't seem to stop us lying to one another, does it? A few years back, someone did some research which was published in a book called The Day America Told the Truth. Apparently, 91% of those surveyed admitted to lying as a matter of routine about things they considered trivial. How about you? 36% were quite happy to lie about big, important matters. How about you? 86% regularly lied to their parents. Do you? 75% routinely lie to friends. What about you? 73% were quite happy to lie to siblings. And 69% were quite happy to lie to their spouses. Again, let me ask, what about you? Now, they didn't ask how many people were prepared to lie to brothers and sisters in Christ, but I bet it's way more than 50%. And St. Paul knows that. And that's why he doesn't pussyfoot around in the passage by saying, "Look, if you've been lying, start telling the truth." He just assumes we all struggle in this area, that we all have issues with telling the truth. "Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbour, for we are all members of one body." Those of you who use social media, that's a great place to lie, isn't it? Let me give you an example. After the Bright Lights party last week, Carol posted a picture on Facebook of the children chasing a giant beach ball around. Well, it was an honest picture. It was what went on. In the background, there was this rather large balding chap trying to set up a balloon drop. That was me, in case you didn't recognise the description. And when I saw that picture of my bald patch, what I wanted to do was, well, have the picture removed and destroyed, to be honest, for showing me with a bald patch. But then I thought, no, actually, that's lying, because truth be told, I do indeed have a bit of a bald patch on top of my head. I'm not going to hide and lie about who I am or what I am. We lie on social media, don't we, lots of us? We carefully choose pictures and stories that show us in the best possible light. For me, that's usually total darkness. And we put all those best possible versions of ourselves on display to the world. And whether it's in social media or whether it's the Christmas letter showing that perfect family who've had a superior year of achievement, we all know, actually, that there's great harm done by these fake presentations of our lives. We know that pretending to be perfectly successful in life harms those who read about it, because, unfortunately, we're all prone to forgetting that what we read online about other people and how we feel on the inside are not comparable things. We should never compare how we feel on the inside with how others look on the outside. Social media identity is not really the correct phrase. I think we should call it a social media lie-dentity. I wonder what an honest Facebook or Instagram profile would look like. Here's me first thing in the morning after just getting out of bed. No, I'm not going to make you suffer through that photo. But maybe as Christians we should take a lead on that, on being truthful in how we present ourselves. And of course it's not just on social media we lie. We do it at job interviews. We tell little white lies to our friends to cover social embarrassment. We tell huge, great, whopping lies when we're determined to get something at any costs. And quite often we get caught out. You might know the story of the shop owner who heard one of his team tell a customer, "No, ma'am, we haven't had any of that for a while, and it doesn't look as if we'll be getting any soon." Well, the manager was horrified. He rushed over to the customer and said, "Of course we'll have some soon. We placed an order just last week." And then the manager took his staff member to one side. "Never," he snarled, "never, never, never say we're out of anything. Say we've got it on order and it's coming soon. Anyway, what was it she wanted?" And the shop assistant replies, "Rain." That's the tragedy of lying. Sooner or later, we get found out. And when that happens, the only solution is to apologise and tell the truth. But even better is not to be lying in the first place. If we want to be imitators of God, then each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbour. And then St Paul continues, verse 29, "Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up." That's where I went wrong in that comedy sketch I was talking about earlier. Unwholesome talk isn't just using foul language. It's trash-talking people in front of a crowd, humiliating others. That's just as unwholesome as swearing and just as destructive. Let's use our words to build others up, not tear them down. This week I've been blessed by two brief conversations I had with teachers, and they're both people with a real and obvious gift for encouraging others. And it was lovely to talk to them because they showed easy and great appreciation for some small things that I'd done for them. They built up, they didn't tear down. Not all of us are as good at that as those two teachers were, but perhaps we can learn. We can practice the skill of building others up. So let me encourage you to set yourself a challenge for this week to work at speaking positively to the people in your lives, and most especially to your brothers and sisters in Christ, to say only what is helpful for building them up. And as we do that, we'll be imitators of God, using our words for good rather than for evil. Okay, so now let's turn things around. We're going to put the metaphorical shoe on the other metaphorical foot and ask, what's it like to be wronged, and how might we respond to it in a way that would make us imitators of God? And here's the first way. We keep calm and don't lose control. Or as verse 26 puts it, in your anger, do not sin. Now, to my friend's credit, when I insulted him so publicly, he didn't lose his temper with me, nor did he punch me in the face, which was probably what I deserved. Instead, he took me to one side and challenged me quite gently about my behaviour. And I think it was the gentleness of his challenge that actually got through to me and made me realise what a rotten thing I'd done. He was definitely angry, but because he wanted to be an imitator of God, he didn't let his anger lead him into sin. Now, most of us, when we get angry, we're prone to doing dumb things, aren't we? Slamming doors, shouting out bad words, and saying and doing dumb things back to the person who's upset us. Guilty as charged. As the old saying goes, speak when you're angry, and you'll make the best speech you will ever regret. So be careful what you do with that anger. It's not that it's wrong to be angry. The Bible shows us time and time again examples of God getting angry. Angry at injustice, angry at fake and false religion. It's what you do with the anger that is important. Stay in control and find a way to channel it into a solution that doesn't involve fists. Here's the second way to respond when wronged. Deal with the problem quickly. Verse 26 continues to say, do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. That means try to fix the problem quickly. Because if we don't, it festers. It, verse 27, gives the devil a foothold. I'm sure you know the sort of thing I mean. You have a row with someone, you go to bed angry, next day you wake up angry, and you ignore each other all day, and you go to bed angry again, and it goes on and on and on. And of course it happens in churches as well, except we tend to see each other only once a week, which means you've got a whole week for things to fester. I've met Christians who have had grudges against other Christians for more than 30 years and never done anything about it. That's not giving the devil a foothold on your life. That's building him a rope ladder straight to the heart of your soul. Deal with the problem quickly. Go to the person who's upset you and say what's wrong, and do it the sooner the better. Here's the third principle for fixing things when they go wrong. Forgive each other. What normally happens when someone wrongs us? Well, we take revenge on them, don't we? We escalate things. He insulted me, so I'm entitled to insult him back. He hit me, I'm entitled to hit him back. Harder. It's a downward spiral of feuding. That's the sort of world the Old Testament rule about an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth was written for. But it does sound very brutal today, doesn't it? Until you remember that the normal response to the loss of an eye in those days was to take two eyes. And the family losing two eyes would probably respond by killing somebody in your family. An eye for an eye was designed to stop feuds escalating. It set a limit on what could be done in a revenge culture. But Jesus' way is totally different. Rather than an eye for an eye, he calls us to turn the other cheek. We're verse 32, to be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ, God forgave you. So if someone wrongs you, turn the other cheek. When someone betrays you, forgive them. If someone acts unreasonably, treat them with compassion. Rather than taking revenge for the offence, take the burden of the offence onto yourself, just as God did in Christ, when he took all of our mistakes and failures to the cross with him. He did that because he loved us. I wonder if we can learn to do that for one another, because that's how we become imitators of God, by forgiving one another, just as in Christ God has forgiven us. I'm going to stop there, except to say that, of course, I've touched on a whole range of rather tricky issues, and there may be things you'd like to talk or pray about afterwards. Do get in touch, and I'd be delighted to talk to you and pray with you about them. So let's turn to prayer now. And why don't we take a moment of quiet to reflect upon the way we speak to others and the way we respond when we are wronged. And then let's resolve to be imitators of God who live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for going to the cross to bear the burden of our sin. Thank you that on the cross, all of our failure, all our mistakes, died with you. Thank you that the consequences are gone, that we're forgiven, we're accepted. We become children of the same Heavenly Father. And so help us to treat one another as brothers and sisters of God. And in doing that, learn to become imitators of God. People who think before they speak. Speak to build up, not to tear down. And people who learn to direct anger away from the person and into transformation. Lord, keep us from taking revenge. Help us instead to seek to forgive those who have hurt and wounded us, just as you have done for us in Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Brother, sister, let me serve you. May I be as Christ to you. We've just been thinking of what it is to be imitators of God. Well, now we're going to sing a lovely hymn about it. Why don't you stand for this if you wish as we sing, Brother, Sister, Let Me Serve You. Let's remain standing as we declare our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, do please take a seat. And here's James Reid, in a field of sheep, to lead us in prayer.
Almighty and most merciful Heavenly Father, we praise and honour your holy name. We thank you for the grace you have given us through the death on the cross of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, and his glorious resurrection. By his sacrifice, our sins are wiped away, and we become children of the one true living God. Praise, honour, and glory to you, both now and forever. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we give thanks that you really are the munificent creator, and we truly marvel at the beauty, complexity, and serenity of your creation. Help us, Lord, to be good stewards of this creation. May we always acknowledge your name in our efforts to preserve it. Without you in our lives, we will never truly be successful or contented. Instead, let the spring of living water that flows inside us change us so we can make a real difference and the world a better place. A world that reflects you and not ourselves. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we thank you for our communities. Let us show compassion and kindness to each other, and may we reflect your love in all our dealings and in all parts of society. Give wisdom, strength, and humility to those who govern us. Let your truth, righteousness, and justice prevail and transform the world we live in. May this transformation be deep-rooted and not superficial or transitory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you for your church and for the work of our local clergy team. May all of us, as the body of Christ, help each other, encourage each other, and work in harmony with each other. May we always focus on Christ and put our trust in you. With abundant joy and powerful authenticity, let us share our faith with others, radiating naturally the gospel in our actions and in the way we live out our lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Please comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. At this time, we especially remember Melanie Wood, Margaret Lithgow, Hazel Parsons, Robert England, Simon Barclay, Mary Purser, Catherine Griffin, Julian Hart, Pam Morton, Jean Trevor Morgan, Jennifer Unwin, and Betty. At this time, may we also remember and pray for the family and friends of anyone who has recently been bereaved. We think especially of the family and friends of Alan Godby, June Walcott, Betty Yap, John Overton, Brian Green, Harry Civil, and Renee Dowson. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Help us, Lord, to live out our Christian lives in a way you want us to, and by the power of your Holy Spirit. Let us bear much fruit in your name. Help us to take every opportunity to put our faith into action, and may we always serve you, our Lord and Saviour, in humility, in gentleness, and most of all, in love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, thanks for that, James. We're going to continue in prayer now as we pray the church's special prayer for this week. And why don't we pray this together? Heavenly Father, whose blessed Son was revealed to destroy the works of the devil and to make us the children of God and heirs of eternal life, grant that we, having this hope, may purify ourselves even as he is pure, that when he shall appear in power and great glory, we may be made like him in his eternal and glorious kingdom, where he is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And gathering all our prayers and praises into one, let us pray with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Well, if you've been watching the news at all in the last week, you can't have failed to notice that there's a very significant climate change conference going on in Glasgow at the moment. COP26, it's called, the Council of the Parties 26. Not the best name, but certainly a wonderful intent. Here's our very own Sue Aidney to remind us about how we can all make a difference.
Hello. I'm sitting outside St Mary's Church, Hanley Castle, which is our local church. We've just achieved silver in the Eco Church Award, and we're progressing now on to gold, which will be much more challenging. And much more challenging will be the results of COP26 taking place at the moment. On Friday evening, before COP started, I was in Worcester at a kind of presentation of Extinction Rebellion as the clocks chimed 6 o'clock to mark the start. We held 2 minutes silence, and a child played in the fountains beneath the cathedral, oblivious really to this bunch of strange people sitting around. And it occurred to me that this is what it's all about. It's about this child and the future that we are leaving him and his children. And that's an enormous responsibility and something that we must rise to. And then I observed that there was another demonstration in Malvern where the feet of children, the shoes of children, had been left on the steps leading up towards the street. Tiny little feet, all facing the same direction, as if walking in a kind of camino, a walk, as there has been through this diocese all the way to Glasgow this week. What are we walking into? What are we laying on the walk, the way, for our children and their children's children? But we do this in the hope that we're looking towards heaven. We're looking towards what God teaches us and invites us to do. And if that is to try and make our churches eco-churches, if that's the least we can do, that's what we must do. For in doing so, we'll be changing hearts and minds and teaching people and encouraging them to join in with God in the healing of his creation that we have so damaged. So that's my prayer for that little boy playing in the fountains. And I do encourage anyone who wants to pursue Eco Church to make bronze or go for silver to get in touch in case we can help. God bless you all.
And if you'd like to know more about Eco Church, do get in touch with Sue Aidney. We're going to finish our service this morning then with a great rousing song, "Even Though I Walk Through the Valley of the Shadow of Death." Why don't you stand for this one, if you wish?
Casting out fear, and even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back. I know you are near, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with, shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Is coming for the heart that holds on, a glorious light beyond all compare. And there will be an end to his troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you here on the earth. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. My God is with me. Whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go. That is coming for the heart that holds on, and there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Yes, I can see, and I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Oh no, never let go through the calm, through the storm. Oh no, never let go every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me.
Listen to that part of the song again. Yes, I can see a light.
Yes, I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you. Still I will praise you.
Sing this one last time. It's our hope.
Yes, I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. and there will be an end to these troubles. But until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you.
Well, thanks for joining us in worship this morning. Do please invite others to join us as we worship online week by week. And if this has been your first time worshiping with us, I hope you've enjoyed it. We'll be here same time next week. We're also meeting in person in our churches together now and able to sing together at last. So if you feel ready to return, do come and add your voice to the chorus. And if there's any way we can help you in your spiritual journey during these unusual times, do get in touch with me, barry@hopechurchfamily.org. And so may Christ, who has opened the kingdom of heaven, bring us to reign with him in glory. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Why don't we finish with the words of the grace?
May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all. Amen.